Namaste, welcome to Koshi School and College of Nursing. Koshi's College of Nursing founded in the year 2003 and is affiliated with Rajiv Gandhi University of Health Science located in Bengaluru, approved by Karnataka Nursing Council and Indian Nursing Council. It's an outstanding academic institution dedicated to educating exemplary nursing professional in accordance with highest professional standard. I, Sharmila Fernandez, lecturer, KCN, take it as a privilege to invite each one of you for Ignite 2020. Knowledge shared is power multiplied, a 3 days of international webinar on clinical competency in nursing education, a global view from 6 to 8 July 2020. Developing training program and the curriculum in the areas of tertiary care is recognized as a need of an hour. The nurse practitioner will be able to meet this demand provided they were trained and legally empowered to practice. Agenda of our international webinar is to create the awareness and to instill more clarity into the grey areas pertaining to this program. KCN has taken initiative to conduct this webinar. On day 1, 6 July 2020, we have official inauguration of a webinar by Honorable Chief Guest Dr. Uday Murgod, Consultant Neurologist, Manipal Hospital, Bengaluru at 10:15 a.m., followed by keynote address on nursing education in India by Dr. K. Reddamma, Nodal Officer, INC Consortium for PhD in Nursing by 10:30 a.m. onwards. On day 2, 7 July 2020 at 3:30 p.m. to 5 p.m, we have panel discussion on clinical competency which focus on nurse practitioner role in nursing, a global view. Panelists are Professor Sandra Kegel, RN, MSN, ACNP, BC, Manager, Advanced Practice Provider, Michigan. Dr. Toby Rabin, RN, MN, PhD, Senior Lecturer and Nurse Practitioner in Mental Health School of Nursing, Western Sydney University. Dr. Soni Sani, District Nurse at PHC, Gothenburg, Sweden. Mrs. Minnie Vargas, ACNP, BC, Auckland Hospital. Moderator for the day, Mrs. Soni Anil, MSN, RN, PM, HNP, BC, College Counselor, KCN and KIMS. On day 3, 8 July at 10:30 a.m. to 11:30 a.m., we have discussion on role of clinical setting in improving competency in nursing education, challenges and hindrance faced by nursing students and the teachers to develop clinical competency in nursing education by Professor M. Maheshwari, Principal Army College of Nursing, Punjab and Dr. Shija, Lecturer, Sydney. Free registration for all academicians and nurses. For more information, kindly visit the following link. Now let's hear from our beloved principal, KCN, Professor Serena Saji. Thank you.
Nurses, once they are adequately trained, they are definitely competent, confident and capable to handle any levels of care. Especially in this COVID-19 pandemic-stricken atmosphere, nurses are recognized greatly as frontline warriors. But let me ask you, how familiar are you with the concept of expanded roles in nursing, that is nurse practitioner? I feel really happy and privileged to invite you all to the international webinar Ignite 2020, which will be conducted by Koshi's College of Nursing on the topic Clinical Competency in Nursing Education, a Global View. Thank you.
Good morning to all. The harder you work for something, the greater you will feel when you achieve it. I welcome each one of you to Ignite 2020. Knowledge shared is power multiplied. On behalf of Koshi School and College of Nursing, I am Ms. Melba Anil, Assistant Professor, Department of Medical Surgical Nursing, extend a very warm welcome to all the esteemed guests. Our chief guest, Dr. Uday Murgod, keynote speaker, Dr. Reddamma, guest of honor, Dr. Santosh Koshi, our beloved chairman, Koshi's Group of Institution, CEO, Mr. Lofi Vellara, Koshi's Group of Institution, Executive Director, Mr. Pankaj Roy, Koshi's Group of Institution, Principal, Professor Serena Shaji, Koshi School and College of Nursing, Dr. A. Ravi, Academic Director, Koshi's Institute of Management Studies, who joined us today, and also all the participants from various fields of nursing and other domain from different part of this world. We are delighted to have you all with us. We are overwhelmed with your energetic response. We have almost 1,700 registration for this webinar. We can see many attendees still joining. As we are overloaded with registration and queries, we are forced to shift to team broadcast so that maximum participants can get benefit out of this. The function of prayer is not to influence God, but rather to change the nature of the one who prays. I look unto Lord Almighty and begin this webinar. The topic selected for this 3 days international webinar is Clinical Competency in Nursing Education, a Global View. In India, reshaping health system in all dimensions of health has been recognized as an important need in the National Health Policy 2015. It emphasizes human resource development in the area of education and training alongside regulation and legislation. The government recognizes significant expansion in tertiary care services, both in public and private health sectors, in building their capacity. It is highly significant that the healthcare professionals require advanced education preparation in specialty and super specialty services. To support specialized and super specialized healthcare services, specialist nurses with advanced preparation are essential. Developing training programs and curriculum in the area of tertiary care is recognized as the need of the hour. Nurse practitioners, NPs, will be able to meet this demand provided they are well trained and legally empowered to practice. I am pleased to present chief guest for the webinar, Dr. Uday Murgod, consultant neurologist, Manipal Hospitals, Bangalore. Dr. Uday completed his MBBS MD from JJM Medical College, Davangere, Doctorate of Medicine in Neurology from NIMHANS, Bangalore. Before joining Manipal Hospitals, he was working with St. John's Medical Hospitals, Bangalore as Assistant Professor, Department of Neurology. He has several publications in various national and international journals. As a seasoned medical professional, I am sure that Dr. Uday will have his valid points to present before this group. We welcome you, sir, and look forward to hear from you. Kindly accept and take over the session.
Sir, unmute your mic, please. Dr. Uday, unmute your mic. Yeah.
Yeah. Can you all hear me now?
Yes, yes, sir.
Yeah, so good morning, and I thank everyone for inviting me, especially Dr. Santosh Koshi, my friend, and the organizers of this webinar. Since we are already running late, I'll be very brief. I understand the purpose of this seminar is basically to improve nursing education and training, particularly with regard to clinical competency. I think finally the aim of all this is to provide, to produce nurses who are better trained so that the quality of healthcare improves. So I think the bottom line is basically healthcare, and everything is geared towards improving that. You seem to have an excellent set of speakers for this occasion. So I will limit myself to basically going through a few facts. Healthcare in India is a major concern. We are a very populous nation. We are a nation of about 1.3 billion people. And as of last year, there were about 11.6 lakh registered allopathic doctors in our country. And if you presume that a portion of them are inactive for various reasons, the doctor patient ratio works out to something like one doctor for 1400 people in our country. If you include other specialties like Ayurveda, Unani and homeopathy, you can add another 6 or 6.5 lakh doctors, and together with them, the doctor patient ratio comes down to something around 1 in 850 or 860. But there is a big divide between the urban and rural areas. We know that a majority of our doctors, about 70 or 75% of doctors, are concentrated in urban areas, and a majority of our population is actually residing in rural areas. So there's a skewed ratio when it comes to doctor patient ratios. In urban areas we have one doctor for 600 patients, but in rural areas we have one doctor for 4000 patients. So this is a little bit about the background of what we are facing here. As it was mentioned, the Indian government had a relook at its health policy in 2015, and the emphasis was on improving education and training so that the capacity to deliver healthcare can be improved. The government also recognized the need to improve tertiary care services, and to support those services, they also acknowledged the need for training specialist nurses. So the concept of nurse practitioner was introduced with this regard. Nurse practitioners have been, the services of nurse practitioners has been available in the United States since the 1960s and in United Kingdom from the 1980s. It is just about introduced in our country. As I understand, it's only available in critical care medicine right now. But I think in the future, other specialties will be added. We have all, as practitioners, experienced situations where we have very little support when it comes to practice. I work in a tertiary care center, and I have gone through situations where we had practically no support at a junior level. We have trained physician assistants in my subject, which is neurology, and we have found that it makes a big difference to the working in our department. It helps improve our services so much better. So I can understand that having nurse practitioners is definitely going to improve our services. I think the government has actually recommended that nurse practitioners should be working in tertiary care centers, but that is only the beginning. I think going forward, I see no reason why nurse practitioners should not work independently if they're legally empowered, or at least under supervision of doctors, so that healthcare can be delivered at all levels, not only in urban areas, but in smaller places as well. So with these words, I congratulate Dr. Santosh Koshi and the College of Nursing for organizing this webinar. I hope that in the near future, you are also going to apply and get sanctioned for this program. I wish you all the best, and I hope you'll be among the first few leaders pioneering nursing education in this country. I wish you all the best in your endeavor. Good luck. Thank you.
Thank you, Dr. Uday Murgot. Your speech would have enriched all our participants, and the importance of nurse practitioners to work in tertiary care and in the community settings. And thank you again for your wishes for Koshi's group of institutions to start with a nurse practitioner course. Thank you, sir.
You're welcome.
The essence of great leadership is influence, not authority. With a spring in my step and anticipation in heart, I invite the guest of honor, Dr. Santosh Koshi, our beloved chairman, senior consultant, pediatrics, medical director, Koshi's NABH accredited multi-specialty hospital, and chairman of Koshi's group of institutions, to address the participants. Over to you, sir. Please take over the session.
Hello.
Yes, sir.
Hello.
You are audible. Yes, sir. You are audible. Yes, sir. You are audible. You can proceed.
Good morning, everybody. Greetings to all speakers and attendees present here. I would also like to acknowledge Dr. Uday Murgot, consultant neurologist, Manipal Hospital, who is our chief guest, and Dr. K. Reddamma, Nodal Officer, INC Consortium for PhD Nursing, who is a keynote speaker for today's seminar. It is an honor to be a part of the international conference, as it makes me very proud that Koshi's College of Nursing took up the initiative to organize this virtual seminar to address the need for clinical competency in nursing education, which is today's topic. This would not have been possible if not for the dedicated and hardworking staff of this college, and I would like to take a moment to thank you all for the success you have brought upon this college. The objective of this seminar is to not only discuss the need for change in nursing education system, but also to understand the requirement of nurse practitioners in India. As the largest and often the most visible force, nurses are the cornerstone of our healthcare system. Nurses have a vital and unique role in delivering acute healthcare. They are on the front line of our health services, often seeing patients and families at their most vulnerable. The nursing profession has developed immensely throughout the decades, and it is now time to explore advanced nursing in India. The evolution of concept and practice of advanced nursing has been long and complex. This has led to innovation in the profession, but also to confusion and misconceptions about what advanced nursing was and is, and what benefits it could bring to the healthcare, which is what we would gain more knowledge about through this seminar. The roots of advanced practice nursing can be traced back to 1890s, but the nurse practitioner emerged in Western countries during 1960s in response to unmet healthcare needs of population in rural areas. Today, advanced nursing is evident in both developed and developing countries. The WHO supports its growth in order to meet growing global healthcare needs. India has a great disparity between the available and required number of nurses as per the population. Hence, there is great demand for qualified nurses all over the country. Apart from this, there is also a shortage of doctors in different states. The shortage is due to uneven rural-urban distribution. It is to try and maintain balance that I believe it is important to train our nurses in the advanced curriculum and bring about the concept of nurse practitioners in India. For this, nurses should be full partners with physicians and other healthcare professionals in redesigning healthcare in India. Strong leadership is critical if the vision of a transformed healthcare system is to be realized. Yet not all nurses begin the career with thoughts of becoming a leader. The nursing profession must produce leaders throughout the healthcare system. Contrasting the strategic vision is our current understanding of what advanced nurses are, what regulates the practice, the potential scope of the roles, and what education is needed for the preparation. For starters, the ideology that nurses are functional doers, those who carry out the instruction of others, and not thoughtful strategists. Those who are informed decision makers and whose independent actions are based on education and experience should be eliminated. Hence, ensuring that nursing continues to distinguish itself from other healthcare professions while securing a seat at multidisciplinary healthcare table will be instrumental in advancing the practice of nursing. Advanced nurses are the cutting edge of nursing innovation, and they challenge the deep-seated traditions of health professions and organizations. This being a vast topic, I'm sure our qualified speakers have broken it down for us for better understanding as to what advanced nursing practitioner is all about and why it is very much essential to implement in India. I hope the rest of this conference turns out to be an exciting educational experience for all of us and to bring about the change that required to help take this healthcare to the next level in this country. Thank you, Vandana. Thank you.
Thank you, sir. As always, your speech was really motivational for each one of us, and your speech made us to think that how important we nurses are in the field of a medical team in the aspect of decision making in taking care of the patient. Thank you, sir. The person says to our nursing students, your limitations are only your imagination. push yourself because no one else is going to do it for you. As a person, he always supports the Department of Nursing with his innovative ideas. Here we have Mr. Pankaj Roy, Executive Director, Koshi's Group of Institution, to address the participants. Over to you, sir. Kindly accept and take over the session.
Thank you, madam. Thank you so much. Om Asatama Sadgamaya Tamasama Jyotirgamaya Mrityurma Amritam Gamaya Om Shanti Shanti Shanti. It means take us from the unreal to the real. Take us from the darkness to the light. Take us from the death to the immortality. Give us peace, peace, peace. The world is under tremendous pain. The humanity is under threat. The people are suffering. It is all happening only because we don't have the knowledge of a vaccine yet. The moment we have the knowledge of a vaccine, this monstrous virus will run away like a street rat. Good morning, one and all. On behalf of Koshi's Group of Institution, I welcome you all from India and across the globe for participating in this event and sharing your knowledge. This will definitely take us from the darkness to the light. We must remember, after COVID, again, humanity will blossom. Again, the life will flow. But there will be some other problem waiting for us. This is life. The only solution is we have to share our knowledge. We have to learn the problem and we have to discover the solution for it. Through this event, let your knowledge take us from the unreal to the real, from the darkness to the light. And even if we are not there tomorrow, let our knowledge remain here forever. Give us peace, give peace to our next generation and move us ahead. Thank you so much. Wish you all the best and let your knowledge help all of us. Thank you.
Thank you, sir. Thank you so much. So you made us to think again, there is no problem without any solution. So always there is a solution for every problem. Thank you, sir. Nurse practitioners have been prepared and functioning in USA since 1960s, UK since 1980s, Australia since 1990s, and Netherlands since 2010. In India, this initiative came to existence in 2019 to create an awareness and to instill more clarity to the grey areas pertaining to this program. KCN has taken this initiative to conduct this webinar on the mentioned topic, Clinical Competency in Nursing Education, a Global View. We are going to have three sessions. On the first day, today, Nursing Education in India, Current Status. On day two, panel discussion on clinical competency with a focus on nurse practitioners' role in nursing, a global view. On the day three, role of clinical setting in improving competency in nursing education. Today, being the first day, we are going to discuss nursing education in India, current status. I know all the participants are eagerly waiting to hear the talk from our speaker, the most important aspect of today's webinar, lectured by Dr. K. Redamma, Nodal Officer, INC Consortium for PhD in Nursing, on the topic Nursing Education in India, Current Status. I hand over the session to Professor Serena Shaji, our beloved principal, Koshi School and College of Nursing, Bangalore, to introduce Ma'am Redamma and accompany the session. Over to Ma'am Serena to take up the session.
Yeah, morning everyone. Some people, you hear them or speak to them, they put a spark inside you. That spark will act as a trigger to achieve heights in your life. If one takes a closer look at the combination of an achieving person, two distinct virtues pop up according to me: a pioneering spirit and willingness. This is what I remember when I talk about our speaker for today's keynote address, Dr. K. Redamma, Nodal Officer, INC Consortium for PhD in Nursing, Bangalore, who's a nursing professional with enriched experience of about 50 years in the field of nursing education. To be very brief about Ma'am Redamma's profile, Ma'am has completed her BSc Nursing in Osmania University, Hyderabad in 1970, and then her Diploma in Psychiatric Nursing from Nimhans, Bangalore, followed by Masters in Nursing from Delhi University and PhD in Nursing from Mangalore University. And Ma'am has shouldered various responsibilities, starting as a tutor in Nimhans and then retiring from the post Senior Professor and HOD of Nursing from Nimhans. Since then, Ma'am is holding the prestigious position as Nodal Officer, INC Consortium for PhD in Nursing, Bangalore. And Ma'am's achievements, contributions, to be very brief, to read out few, at least for the awareness of the audience, as we have many people from different part of the country and different part of the globe, I would like to read few points. In contributions made at Nimhans, the major points include: developed curriculum for diploma in neuro nursing, which is a 1-year course in 1982, and started conducting this course, which is going on from 1982 till now. Developed curriculum for MSc psychiatric nursing, 2 years post-graduation course, which is going on from 1988 till now. Ma'am is has given research guidance to postgraduate students since 1989 till date. Ma'am is a life member of TNAI and life member of Nursing Research Society of India, and served as vice president from 1991 to 1999. Ma'am was elected as the president of Indian Society of Psychiatric Nurses, ISPN, which is a prestigious professional organization, and life member of Indian Society of Psychiatric Nurses. And national level contribution includes: Ma'am is the Nodal Officer of National Consortium for PhD in Nursing by Indian Nursing Council in collaboration with RGHS Karnataka from 2006 till date, and guided so many students and contributed greatly towards the growth of nursing profession, nursing research, and nursing education as a whole. And Ma'am's international contribution also includes: served as a resource person for developing curriculum, BSc nursing curriculum, for BP Koirala Institute of Medical Sciences, Dharan, Nepal, during 1996. Ma'am has so many publications, national and international, to her credit, and also a Silver Jubilee Award winner from Nimhans for 25 years of service. And as a nurse educator in India, when we are looking at the current scenario of nursing education program, I believe there is nobody else who have experienced in and out through the nursing education patterns in India, what's happening in India, to speak to us with authority and power on the given topic. So I'm very proud to invite our beloved Dr. E. Redamma to take over the session. Over to you, ma'am. Ma'am, we can start. We can see the slide. We can see, yeah. Ma'am, also everything is perfect, ma'am. You okay. May please go ahead with your presentation.
Thank you very much for inviting me, and I'm very happy to be part of this mega event by Koshi's group of institutions. And all that I'm going to do is to share the process that we went through regarding nurse practitioner course in India. Slide over. Next. Stop sharing with Davantala.
Hello.
I'll just take you through the type of nursing courses in India and ANM, GNM, BSc nursing. And I think the mindset of people in the society has stopped at GNM. And most of the nurses are perceived as at GNM level. And of course, awareness regarding BSc nursing is also there. And as the public image goes on, it is perceived as only on the bedside, not regarding anything else, and not contributing in a meaningful and contributing by the nurses is only perceived at bedside level. Then we have started with post-certificate courses, about 16 of them in 90s. There was not much response for these courses because there was no incentive attached to this. So wherever they started these courses, there were no takers. Then MPhil in nursing was started in MG University, Kerala, and Manipal Institute, and also in Delhi University. And in this regard, MPhil was taken up by few from the colleges. Meanwhile, PhD program in nursing also was started from different places, but we did not have nursing guides to guide the PhD students. They have taken, and at that point of time, there were no PhD in nursing. Hence, a doctor was taken as a guide and a nursing person was taken as a co-guide. Then now there are many institutions conducting PhD program at both deemed universities, some of the oldest universities, and nursing consortium. We started working in 2002 and finally we started in 2006, and about 15 batches have been recruited under national consortium. The next in the pipeline is doctorate in nursing practice. That is in the pipeline. We are working at it. Next slide. Yeah. Okay. Coming to critical nursing, it is a system, not a standalone unit, and it is immediate life-threatening health condition. Vital organs are at risk of failing and they are elements of critical care. Then the critical care system is only in tertiary care hospitals, and there is no such provision in the at district and taluk or rural areas. So if any patient requires critical care, bringing to a tertiary care hospital, you lose a lot of time and that can endanger the life of the patients. Then disintegrated healthcare system. See, in 1990s, there was a move that all the people from the rural areas be brought to the intensive care units in the tertiary care hospitals, train them to identify when to shift the patient from these hospitals. Such exercise was carried out in Karnataka under Karnataka Health Systems, and we from NIMHANS were a part of it, where they should identify and then shift the patients in a ambulance care, which can support them and shift them to tertiary care hospitals. This is what we mean by integrated healthcare system. People from working in rural areas should come to tertiary care hospitals, learn and go back. And at the same time, the people from tertiary care hospitals should go and work in the rural areas and say, you know, find out the realities in the rural areas and accordingly guide people who are working there. That's what we mean by integrated healthcare system. Then human resource required numbers in all the shifts, different skills required, trained and trained needs of ventilators, ventilator care and technical guidelines and when to use the ventilators. The decision has to be taken when it is necessary and when to use. Then critical care is a continuum starting from triaging, emergency room care, transporting to intensive care unit, transfer out to inpatient care and post-discharge care. So organizational structure in critical care is different in different countries. Like ventilatory support decisions, who takes it? So in India, mostly doctors, the anesthesiologist, they take critical care specialists. They are in charge of the critical care units. See, earlier there was a time where anesthesia was given by most of the male nurses. And in the medical care, it was the least preferred specialty. But once the ventilatory care and intensive care units, critical care units came into existence, now anesthesia is becoming a preferred specialty even for the medical people. And in this context, 24 hours the nurses are there in the critical care units. So if we train them well, the patient safety can be ensured. So that was the philosophy with which the independent practitioner in critical care came. Just to digress a little bit, what did we do? What kind of process went through before thinking of this? Number one, Government of India has reflected in its document that nurses should be trained in critical care as independent practitioners. And then later on, we did a process of circulating what all skills required for working in critical care units for the nurses. So we listed down these units, areas, the activities that nurses have to carry out in critical care units, and collected data as to can the nurses do these activities independently. So after collecting the data, we had a very encouraging data saying that these can be carried out by the nurses. So in the some of the area, I think I'll skip this slide. What are the less expensive modes of care? One is high flow nasal oxygen, pulse oximeter in primary care settings. There's a very good success story being reported in the media as well as in the newspaper just 3 days ago, how they have contained coronavirus disease in Dharavi. And easy identification of respiratory failure can be done by pulse oximeter. Then oxygen concentrators can be used in many settings and including their own homes if needed. Then instituting simple protocols, what to do, when to do, and what are the situations in which you have to decide what to do. Then referral, transport, standards of care, during transport coordination of care from primary care to transit and receiving at the tertiary care units. So there are beautiful systems in other countries. For example, when I visited Australia, there's a beautiful coordination of shifting the patients by air in Australia from the remote areas. So here, though there are occasions when it is used, but it is not very popular or as popular as in other countries. Then nurse practitioners are highly qualified healthcare providers who undergo rigorous educational preparation. Here, 80% practical and only 20% theory or classroom teaching. So in this regard, even the pass marks are very high because they have to be really skillful. 80% is the pass percentage. And just I would like to mention, we have tried this in around 2000, nurse midwifery independent practice. There also same criteria was adopted. And at the same time, we had no problem with the registration of these candidates because they were already registered nurse and registered midwives. So there, when we had independent practice instituted, we had no problem with the registration and we had no problem with the certification. But then now when the critical care issue came, when it was presented in Nirman Bhavan, they said, you should have done it 50 years ago. This initiative could have come 50 years ago. So there was a clearance from Ministry of Health and Family Welfare regarding this program. Another program which was presented was nurse practitioner in the primary care, that is also through from Government of India, Ministry of Health. One should realize healthcare team does not belong to a single provider. The final outcome is the patient recovery and patient welfare. We all have roles in the team, and each one of us have to be very clear about our roles and play it accordingly. Healthcare teams are dynamic with the needs of the patients, directing who best can lead the team at any given point of time. But if you look at the current scenario in most of the critical care units, there are protocols developed for each one of the problems. So it is not individual based, but it is protocol based. When a situation occurs, do's and don'ts are prescribed in the form of protocols. Whether it is a doctor or a nurse or anybody in that unit should follow the protocol. Then who takes the final responsibility for the patients? It is the institution which admits these patients, finally will be held responsible if anything goes right or wrong. But there is no fear for the healthcare team working in the critical care units, as the final responsibility lies with the organization. So if you have that kind of mindset that it is protocol based and everybody has their own roles to play, then everybody feels comfortable to work with that protocol based do's and don'ts. Then flexible frameworks are required for innovation and creation of emerging models to provide high quality care. What do we mean by this? See, sometimes a procedure is prescribed. If there is any situation, any new method or any new issue that has arisen, somebody has tried it and succeeded, that can become part of the protocol gain. Current research on innovative nurse practitioner-led models of care demonstrates the success of nurse practitioner as a team leader for primary care as well. and nurse practitioners are adequately educated, prepared to provide safe, high quality primary care to their patients. This, I just put this slide because this is also in the pipeline to be started in the country. So what are the basic requirements? One should be a graduate and having knowledge, skills and abilities that are essential to independent clinical practice. Scientific foundation competencies, critically analyze data and evidence for improving advanced nursing practice. So let us say for example, a biochemical report has come and you have noticed something there. So you should be able to immediately take action on that. Not, don't lose time in initiating action in the. So for to that effect, there has to be a quick action for the remedial measures. Then she integrates knowledge from the humanities and sciences within the context of nursing science. You must realize for us it is a everyday affair, you know, seeing the patients in the critical care units and seeing the patients dying is a everyday affair for us. But for a family, it is a life event. So we need to realize and be very sensitive to the feelings of the family members and communicate to them accordingly, and not to be, you know, not to be thinking in the lines that we think in the hospital, but keep in mind the patient belongs to family and it is a life event for the family and not a everyday event like what we experience. Then translate research and other forms of knowledge to improve practice, process and outcomes. This is again, you have to, you gain some knowledge while in the practice and hence you come out with some innovative methods and practice that again and see the outcome. If that outcome is better, that can become a policy. So we develop new practice approaches based on the integration of research, theory and practice knowledge. And for this, documentation is very, very important. If you have to analyze the data, you need to have documentation in place. So I have seen some hospital, for example, BM Birla in Calcutta. The documentation is so beautiful. At any given point of time, one patient with one nurse, 24 hours. So when you calculate the manpower of nurses, it is it will be very you know, unacceptable to the people. Why so many nurses? Only beds are this many. You have to have provision for one patient with one nurse, 1:1 ratio under all the circumstances, and also see that provision is there for the leave, provision is there for the shifts, 3 shifts in a day. So the calculations have to be based on the data that is gathered. So what are some of the leadership competencies required? Assumes complex and advanced leadership roles to initiate and guide change. Provide leadership to foster collaboration with multiple stakeholders, that is patients, community, integrated healthcare teams, and policymakers to improve healthcare. Demonstrates leadership that uses conflict and reflective thinking, critical and reflective thinking. Advocates for improved access, quality, and cost-effective healthcare. Advances practice through the development and implementation of innovations and in incorporating principles of change. And that is how today the healthcare has emerged, by innovations and incorporating all such changes that have occurred, and that was based on everyday clinical practice. Communicates practice knowledge effectively both orally and in writing. Participates in professional organizations and activities that influence advanced practice nursing on health outcomes of population in focus. Quality competencies. Uses best available evidence to continuously improve quality of clinical practice. This is the quality standards do not stop at one point of time. It has to be continuous quality improvement we should keep in mind, and accordingly, whatever is best or evidence-based practice need to be in place. Evaluates the relationship among access, cost, quality, and safety and their influence on healthcare. See, when it comes to safety, nothing can be more emphasized than having 24 hours skilled nurses on the bedside that can ensure safety of the patient care. And you can think of a situation where a skilled nurse in a critical care unit 24 hours, how much difference it can make. Evaluates how organizational structure, care, process, financing, marketing, and policy decisions impact the quality of healthcare. Apply skills in peer review to promote a culture of excellence. This can be like in a city, in a hospital, there are many tertiary care hospitals. So they can link up with each other and you can build a culture of excellence. Anticipate variations in the practice and is proactive in implementing interventions to ensure quality. Policy inquiry competencies provide leadership in transition of new knowledge into practice. If I'm running out of time, please tell me. I can just read out the titles and then not go into details. Is it okay?
No, ma'am. No, ma'am. The only one class presentation is there. No, ma'am. You can take your own time, ma'am. Okay, please. Thank you.
Generates knowledge from clinical practice to improve practice and patient outcomes. How do we generate this knowledge? See, when you feel there is something has worked better, and as I mentioned earlier, the documentation and analyzing that data which was collected. Then it applies clinical investigative skills to improve health outcomes. I must tell you, just day before yesterday, we had somebody from KLE Belgaum. These nurses were trained in critical care and they are employed as well in KLE hospital. And the excitement that they had in working and the job satisfaction they are experiencing is marvelous. So leads practice inquiry individually or in partnership with others, disseminates evidence from inquiry to diverse audience using multiple modalities, analyzes clinical guidelines for individualized application into practice. Technology and information literacy competencies. Integrate appropriate technologies for knowledge management to improve healthcare. Translates technical scientific health information appropriate for various user needs. So just now I was just referring to the use of pulse oximeter and how they have, succeeded in containing Bombay Dharavi thing. So it is like you have to critically think what works better, what doesn't work better, how to influence that change. assess the patients and caregivers' educational needs to provide effective, personalized healthcare. See, what patients and caregivers' educational needs can cut down the number of hospital days if you are able to train them and help them. This again we have tried way back in 80s and 90s, like teaching family members to carry out certain activities and discharge them earlier. Not only that, now the concept is patients recover in a familiar surroundings much better than in the hospital. Number two, you can avoid a lot of nosocomial infections that is possible in the hospital setup. And from human point of view, family members will have less burden of commuting to hospital every day and somebody staying in the hospital. So these things can be cut down if you are able to train the family members, and if they can be of made use of, their presence can be made use of for certain caregiving activities, that can reduce the burden on the nursing people as well. Then coaches the patient and caregivers for positive behavior change. Positive behavior change is very, very important, because if you can eliminate the fear and make them to feel relaxed, and that can add to the immunity levels and it can help. Like, you know, nurses are having a very bad image in the public because they want the patients to sleep and have rest. And in the hospitals, especially in the beginning stages of hospitalization, there will be mad rush to come to the hospital and visit and show their sympathies, etc. And nurses prevent that. And they don't listen. The nurses shout. And then the image is nurses shout at public. That is the image nurses have because of this situation. So demonstrates information literacy skills in complex decision making, contributes to the design of clinical information systems that promote safe, quality and cost effective care. Uses technology systems that capture data on variables for the evaluation of the nursing care. So in a hospital, how do you set your standards for nursing care, or how do you set what standards or benchmarks for nursing? So in a given situation, in a patient who is admitted, this should happen, this should not happen. So what are the nursing indicators of good nursing practice, and what are the indicators for not so good nursing practice? Policy competencies demonstrates an understanding of the interdependency of policy and practice. See, interdependency, we have to depend on many stakeholders in a healthcare situation. It could be lab, it could be a physiotherapist, or it could be occupational therapist, whoever it is. Each one should respect each other's contribution and behave accordingly, and not to blame each other. So blaming each other can create a very negative work culture and very negative feelings among the people, and no blame game and no passing the buck and no one particular word that is no passing the blame to some other person. If you have done something wrong, accept it, correct it, and take the responsibility if something has gone wrong with you. So advocates for ethical policies that promote access, equity, quality, and the cost. Nowadays, you know, in the COVID times, we are facing a lot of these cost, you know, equity, quality, and the cost. Many hospitals are reporting we have spent 1.5 lakhs, 1.75 lakhs, but patients are not able to pay. Or patients are getting better and going without paying. These are the reports we are getting from various hospitals. So there are different issues related to this. So if you are able to gather such funds for the care of the patients, you should be working towards it, or there are people in the hospitals to work towards it. Analyze ethical, legal, and social factors influencing policy development. Contributes in the development of health policy, which of course this is not possible at every level, but in each hospital, the nurses can contribute for the health policy within the hospital. Of course, there are people participating at healthcare policy at the national level as well. Analyze the implications of health policy across the disciplines. Evaluate the impact of globalization on healthcare policy development. Health delivery system competencies. Applies knowledge of organizational practices. If you are recruited in a particular hospital, you should know the organization policies, complex systems to improve healthcare delivery. Effects the healthcare change using broad-based skills, including negotiation, consensus building, and partnering. So negotiation skills are very, very important. If you feel something is good for the benefit of the patients, you should be able to sit across the table and negotiate with the people concerned so that that benefits the patients. The sole aim should be the benefit to the patients. As nurses, you are advocates of patients, and you should be able to work towards that goal of negotiating for the patient's benefit. Minimizes the risk to patients and provides at the individual and system level. So just let me say, minimizing the risk to patients. You can think of number of instances where you can minimize the risk. Let me take, for example, a wound dressing. See, if you are able to do a dressing without damaging granulation tissue that is being formed, that itself is minimizing the risk. I'm just giving one simple example. Facilitates the development of healthcare system and addresses needs of culturally diverse populations, providers, and other stakeholders. Because culturally diverse populations will have their own belief systems, or will not, for example, a culture that will not accept blood transfusions. So just one such example. Evaluates the impact of healthcare delivery on patient, providers, stakeholders, and the environment. Analyzes and organizational structure, functions, and resources to improve the delivery of care. Collaborates in planning and transition across the continuum of care. Ethics competencies. Integrates ethical principles in decision making. Evaluate the, it's based on no harm to any human being. Evaluates the ethical consequences of decisions. Applies ethically sound solutions to complex issues related to individuals, population, and systems of care. So at every time, the ethical principles should be guiding your day-to-day, hour-to-hour, and minute-to-minute actions. Let us take simple example of taking care of patients with principles, or what you should not be doing, causing any little harm, should not be done by any healthcare professional. Independent practice competencies. functions as a licensed independent practitioner. Let me spend some time here. When we wanted the certification from different universities, the government organizations have put a big block for awarding the degrees for this course. Why? I don't want to go into the details, but most of the government organizations, there was a big block. But deemed universities have taken up the responsibility of awarding the degrees. About 14 institutions have taken up this responsibility of training and giving the degrees. Now, there are people coming out of these courses. And as I get the information from all over the country, they are like hotcakes. And we have to see their performance to see that they are grabbed everywhere. It is already happening and it will happen in future also. Because as I told you, just the day before yesterday, we had online training, and at the same time we could see the excitement and job satisfaction and the appreciation from the authorities about their functioning in the critical care units. And accountability demonstrates highest level of accountability in professional practice. What you do, you should be able to take the responsibility, and that is based on ethical guidelines. Practices independently managing previously diagnosed and undiagnosed patients. Provides the full spectrum of healthcare services to include health promotion, disease prevention, health protection, anticipatory guidance. That is, in the anticipatory guidance, let us take for example, a patient has come with a head injury to emergency. When the patient is being discharged, you should be able to tell them what to anticipate, when to rush back, and how to take help. So, use advanced health assessment skills to differentiate between normal variation of normal and abnormal findings. Employ screening and diagnostic strategies in the development of diagnosis. Prescribes medications with scope of practice, manages health illness status of patients and families over time. Provides patient-centered care, recognizing cultural diversity and the patients or designee as full partner in the decision-making. Works to establish relationship with the patient, characterized by mutual respect, empathy, and collaboration. Creates climate of patient-centered care to include confidentiality, privacy, comfort, emotional support, mutual trust and respect. Incorporates the patient's cultural and spiritual preferences, values and beliefs into the healthcare. Preserves the patient's control over decision-making, that is, eventually the patient consent is very important for whatever procedures being carried out, negotiating a mutually acceptable plan of care. If any patient refuses, you should be able to negotiate and help the patient to accept.
Ma'am, can we? I got a lot of questions because what happened was because the number of participants were so much, and then as we mentioned, we didn't want to deprive anyone of the opportunity. So we moved to broadcast. So then we told them to just, you know, keep the questions posted directly to us. And I got a lot of questions, ma'am. If your time is there, few minutes, you can just answer some of the important questions.
I have time. You can pose questions.
Ma'am, can I interfere, ma'am? Please stop sharing, ma'am. Please stop sharing.
the screen. No? Lonia, please stop sharing. Yeah, so the first question, like, you know, as it has been clearly explained about the competencies, what is expected in this particular role, like, you know, where in detail competencies were explained. If you, in brief, summarize what is the difference between MSc nursing and nurse practitioner course?
Yeah, in short. It's a very good question. MSc nursing honestly does not have as much clinical exposure as these practitioners have. Because here, MSc nursing, you send them to some hospital and most of it is theory based. And whereas here it is hands-on training, they have to be in the clinical area and 80% pass mark in the practice as well as 80% practical oriented practice and 20% only is the theory. And they have to be in the clinical area to gain the skills, which does not happen in MSc nursing. Because MSc nursing has other requirements, like, you know, other subjects to study and other subjects to, you know, appear for the examination. That much clinical time is not devoted in MSc nursing program.
Can put it in speaker mode so you can hear.
That answered the question, whoever has posed this question. Ma'am, there's one more question. As the competencies, what is expected is different for these two programs, is there any difference in the trainers? Like, for example, the teachers who are involved in the program, which is given by the INC?
Yeah, it's again a very important question, I would say. When we did the inspection to different institutions, there were very good skilled senior nurses in each one of these units. Okay. And at the same time, teachers from the colleges of nursing did not have that much clinical competence as these senior nurses had. So we took them as mentors. Both will work together. Theory component is the input from the teachers from the college, and whereas practical input was taken from the clinical area who have been working there for X number of years. And not only that, we call them as proctors, and they collaboration with the nursing teachers from the college will guide and teach them in the clinical area. So we have taken people who have been in the clinical area and have good clinical skills to mentor these trainees.
Okay, I think that answered to that question. And ma'am, next question is, are all these institutions with this course prepare them with the expected level of their performance? Will there be a need for licensing exam before they actually enter into practice?
Licensing, we have to bring in this change in the amendment of the rules. And right now, certification is by the degree, and this goes as an additional degree in their councils.
Okay, so maybe we can expect that in near future it will come up, ma'am, at least as nurse practice.
It is come up. It has come up. People have come out of the training. People are being employed.
Okay, and ma'am,
and also their competencies are already recognized.
Okay. Ma'am, next question is, again, I think in terms of competency, this can be explained, but then to satisfy, what all roles can be taken up by these people? Maybe, as you said, I think you can answer this question, ma'am, because some people have already come up and they are employed at different roles and responsibilities.
You see, like, if you look at the competencies that are listed in the course curriculum itself, if you go through competencies, that is listed competencies have to be acquired by the candidates during the course of training.
Okay, ma'am, a few more questions are there. As a nurse practitioner, do we have permission to prescribe medications in the critical care settings, and are we allowed to take decision in the emergency situation like a physician? If yes, to what extent?
No, as I mentioned earlier, any critical care functions on protocols. If trained nurses are following these protocols, nobody can question that. And for your information, all of you, if you are interested, go through Drugs and Pharmaceutical Act. Okay? It doesn't say who should prescribe the drugs. See, initially what we did was, while working on this issue, we have even recruited a legal person in the group. And out of my own interest, I went through the Drugs and Pharmaceutical Act. Nowhere I could find that who should prescribe the drugs. But here, as I am mentioning, the protocol based functioning in the critical care, it is protocol based. See, in my hospital in NIMHANS, we all used to sit and write down the protocols for emergency situations, for the respiratory unit, for the critical care unit. We as a team used to sit and prepare the protocols. So anybody has to follow that protocol, which is final. So like if you see the prescription powers, that also will be incorporated in the training, and registration, we are trying for the separate registration as well. But the ideal thing would be that these people have to undergo again a separate licensing test and be certified to carry out the activities listed in the program. But right now it is only university degree.
Ma'am, one more question. Role of nurse practitioner in Indian healthcare system, and how far it's needed in comparison with other countries?
I think the other countries, we are far behind other countries. And in due course of time, let us hope we'll come to some level. But as of now, this is a happy situation. Many people have 14 institutions conducting this program, and people have come out, they are being employed. And those who are employed, we need to assess their competencies and then come to a conclusion. And also public and the organization should appreciate this. And appreciation is already there. But what I would be happy is to collect the data on that. Collect the data and analyze the data on that. That is in terms of patient satisfaction, in terms of appreciation of competencies by the other team members, and the patient outcome, and how much it has made a difference than before. And after these people got into the intensive care units, what difference have they made?
This, I think, ma'am, individual institutions should take up the responsibility of doing this, where they started and then publish on it, and then maybe that can really have an impact. Ma'am, next question, legal responsibility of nurse practitioner in critical care settings, to what level it can go?
See, right now it is only trained people being placed in the critical care units. Okay. Yes. And it is not the nursing director of that institution should be able to gather this kind of data from the patient satisfaction, from the team member satisfaction, and the outcome. Outcome in terms of no complications and faster recovery, and patient number of hospital days reduction, and no nosocomial infections. You can have some benchmarks, and you know, do the data analysis based on that.
Yes, ma'am. Thank you, ma'am. Ma'am, this one more question I would like to read. So it says, with the introduction of middle level health providers in the syllabus, government plans to take care of rural health by nurses working in sub centers with autonomy. So will nurse clinicians get this autonomy, or nurse practitioners get this autonomy?
See, this model has been tried in CMC Vellore. And we took that model of primary care nurse, independent primary health care nurse, and the syllabus was prepared and submitted to Ministry of Health, and it is in the process. It is not launched as yet.
Okay. Okay, ma'am. Ma'am, I think this should be the last question, because some questions are again repeating. So if nurses start working as nurse practitioners, then are we allowed to start clinics? If so, will doctors not oppose this?
Yeah, it can happen. But once the licensing is there, then within the licensing, what they are supposed to do, they can do.
Okay. I think no more questions. Some questions were repeating. Keeping that in mind, I've just selected some questions, and I've just covered it. So maybe just to, before I handing over the session to Melba, I must tell you, this particular webinar was an answer to so many questions which was posed on to me. So I had always this doubt within me, because when this nurse practitioner course started, many people asked me, what is the difference between MSc nursing and nurse practitioner program? And from then I had this in my mind. And from a person who is really authorized and who is competent enough and experienced, and who's an expertise in the field, should answer to these questions. So then I think that many of our queries are clarified, and it was a very clear, well spoken explanation, ma'am. And though many of the leaders are aware about what is nurse practitioner program, what are the competencies expected from them after finishing this program, etc., but the majority of the people who are outside that core committee or core leadership roles are not aware about it. So ma'am, thank you so much for explaining all that in detail. And I personally, and on behalf of Koshi's group of institutions and College of Nursing, thank you, ma'am, for coming to us and then giving us such a detailed explanation and clarifying our doubts. Thank you so much, ma'am. Thank you.
If I may have to conclude, when the child is born, parents will have so many expectations. And when they start going to LKG, UKG, if the child is performing well, they say, oh, my child is the best. Okay, what final product comes out of the child is like the situation currently we are in.
Yes.
Okay, the gestation period is over, training is over, and employability has come in. And then we have to see the outcome in terms of patient outcome and assess that. Then we are able to confidently say that, yes, this has worked. So I would put it that way. It is in the infancy stage, especially the employability is in infancy stage, but there are encouraging results we are getting. And like these two, when this was presented to the fourth year BSc nursing students in St. John's by the president INC, the move that we are taking regarding this training, everybody jumped at it. After my BSc, I'm going to take this course. After my BSc, I'm going to take this course. That was the response we had from the graduates. But it is just unfortunate in the government sector, not very encouraging situation. And it took a long time to convince them. Though inspections are over, sanction is given, but still at least 14 deemed universities have trained and they have employed them in the critical care areas.
Yes, ma'am. Thank you. Thank you so much, ma'am. Hope we will, anyway, thank you for all the initiative which has been taken by you as a nurse leader, ma'am, in supporting and then, you know, promoting this program. Thank you, ma'am.
Thank you, ma'am. It was Reddamma. It was a brainstorming session. You explained well about the budding to blooming stage of nurse practitionership course. Your talk would have encouraged many of the participants to choose up this course and to enrich their future. Thank you, Ma'am Serena, for being a moderator for this session. Thank you.